the 6th chapter. If you want to look there in your Bible with me today, if you have an electronic Bible or good old handheld Bible, you know what I love about a handheld Bible, a leather Bible, whatever you call it, is that every time I read out of it, I'm never tempted to go check my social media. You know, but when you're on that phone, it's easy to see those notices coming up and get distracted real quick. I'm old school for sure. We're gonna talk a little bit about where Jesus speaks of the Lord's Prayer. I want to tell you something. Years ago, the man that probably influenced me as much as anybody did when it came to prayer was a man by the name of Ray Maddox. He actually worshiped with us years ago here, and he said something to me I've never forgotten. He said, "Pastor, when you get up to preach, there's one word that you can say that'll bring more guilt to the people of God than any other word." I'm thinking of some sin or something, and he said, "No, the word is prayer." He said, "Most of the times when Christians just hear the word prayer, they get guilty because no one believes that they pray enough or their prayer life is strong enough." And so we don't want this to be a guilt thing. We want to dive into wherever we are in our prayer life and learn to grow in that prayer life, to learn to take it to a whole new level in what we are doing. So be encouraged, be cheerful, learn how to walk in this relationship with God. I want to just get in it afresh and anew. I've never really taught directly out of the Bible on the Lord's on the Lord's Prayer. In Matthew chapter, I think I told you five, Matthew 6, is where we need to go today, and I'm going to read to you a passage of scripture there, and then we're going to dive into it, see if we can't learn something about the Lord and about this thing called prayer today. I'm going to begin reading back in verse 5, establish a little context for how he gave this prayer in the midst of his Sermon on the Mount. So Jesus says in verse 5, in this sermon that he is teaching the people, he says, "And when you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the streets, that they may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But you, when you pray, go into your room." That word room there is a word that we get the word thesaurus from. It's the treasure room. Go into the place you value the most. Go into that treasure room, and when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask him." Now, I put it up on the next screen there, has the whole Lord's Prayer on it. And you know, I've learned something. We all learned the Lord's Prayer a little differently, didn't we? I learned it in the old King James. "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name," and "these," and all that stuff. That's just the way I say it because that's the way I learned it. But if we're going to say it together, we ought to all be on the same page, okay? And trespasses or debtors, you know how all those different ones are in there. So let's say it with the New King James Version. Will you say it with me together? Because Jesus said, "In this manner you are to pray." Say it with me. "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Now I want you to look at the one phrase we're going to look at today. It's the very beginning of the prayer, and it simply says this: "Our Father in heaven." Our Father in heaven. I want to speak to you today on good Father. That's who he is. Somebody ought to write a song on the basis of that title of the sermon that I have today. Good Father. That's who he is. Pray with me just one more time today. Father, we take just a moment and ask you to bless us with your presence and your anointing. Help us not just communicate history and theology and facts, but let the anointing of God, let us have revelation from your heart to ours, so that, Lord, we might please you and might further our relationship with you, learning to pray in the way you have told us to pray. In Jesus' name, amen. I've spent my entire ministry teaching people to pray the way that I learned how to pray. I know when I was early in my relationship with the Lord and I was just so young and new in it and I was enjoying my times, but sometimes I would say, you know, I'm going to set aside an hour to pray. And I would sit there with that hour and I'd get scared. What am I going to say for an hour? What am I going to do for an hour? That looked like 60 minutes, looked very long once I had sat down in that time. And I heard from a very famous teacher about how to pray an hour a day by using the Lord's Prayer. And he said, you know, Jesus didn't really intend for us to pray a 21-second prayer. You know, he really intended for us to see the depth of what he's saying and really use it as demarcations or as goals or as subject headings as you would go through it. Did you ever take a test in high school or college and you had to give like 10 reasons for something and you thought, how am I going to remember these? And you made a little acrostic or you made a little, you know, first letter of each answer and you'd say, oh, when I get asked that, it's TTMFG or something. And you just remember that. So you'd go in there and that jog your memory what the answers were. Well, in some way, that's what I believe Jesus did with giving us the Lord's Prayer. I the best way I know to illustrate that is to think when I was in high school, I ran cross country. And in training for cross country, guess what you do? You run longer distance than you're even going to run in the races that are before you. So our coach would take us out in front of our high school, and he'd say, all right, boys, and the girls, or the girls too, said, you're going to run to the junior high school and back today. And I thought, that was a long way. And I thought, I can't run that far and back. And he said, well, here's what you do. Don't think about running all the way to the junior high and running back. He said, just think about running to the Gloria Sutton Mansion right down the road. And then when you get there, think about running to the railroad tracks. And then when you get to the railroad tracks, you know, think about getting on to the junior high school. And then when you get there and take a breath, go back the same way with each little section. That way you're not thinking of the big thing, you're looking at the little. And I have prayed that way effectively. I've enjoyed many times with the Lord, spending time going through the Lord's Prayer in that way. But I have a confession to make to you today, and the confession is very simple. I very rarely ever make it to the end. I barely get past, you know, kingdom come, will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And usually by the time I'm exploring that and I've gone through our Father who's in heaven and how holy your name is, your Jehovah Jireh, your Jehovah Sidkenu, your Jehovah Shalom, and you spend time meditating and praying and thanking God and listening to Him, and I get to about that third verse and my time's run out. Something's calling for me. I have an appointment. I have something else to do. And so I've learned recently the value of just reading the prayer. Matter of fact, you know what I've been doing? Can I confess this today? I've been singing the Lord's Prayer. You know the great song that we sing is mainly soloists that sing the Lord's Prayer? And you'll be very thankful that I only sing that in the presence of the angels and God in my car, usually. And alone, but I'll sing, and I'll sing portions of it. I'll come into it so that I see the whole picture of everything that God is doing. So I believe you can do both. You know, I believe real strongly with Pastor Mark Rutland, a great pastor, who said there's two people that have ruined the Lord's Prayer for us and are two extremes. He said, you know, mainly the Roman Catholic Church in the Middle Ages, when they came up with this idea of doing Hail Marys and praying Our Fathers, they called it. So if you've done certain sins, go pray two Our Fathers and three Hail Marys. And it turned it into a liturgical matter of reciting words rather than anything intimate with God. But I'll tell you who else has ruined it. We have charismatics, Pentecostals, some people that are way over here. Why have they ruined it? Because they won't read it because it's too liturgical. I don't want to do it. Pastor Mark Rutten, a president of a great school up here in Oklahoma, and he said he had the kids all say it. He had two parents come to him when they found it out and said, we're pulling our kids out of school. We didn't send them there to be liturgical and be formal. We sent them there to find the Spirit. Well, you see, you can do both. You can recite it and still get in. So both extremes are wrong. You can enjoy this. Jesus said, here's how you pray. And he said, here it is. He spoon feeds us and says, say these words right here. And oh, the depth of these words that he has given us. Now, before we dive into just our Father here today, I want to look at the immediate context that I read to you and just point out a few things real quickly. First of all, I love how he begins in verse 5, and when you pray. I could just preach all day on that. And when you pray. You know what when you pray means? It means not if you pray, but when you pray. It is understood that a disciple, a follower of Jesus Christ, is going to pray. And when you pray. And you know what else that it says? When kind of expects a time. When do you pray? Do you pray when you get up in the morning? Do you pray on your drive in at work? Do you pray on, you know, at night? Do you pray all those times? What's your set aside time to pray? I pray. But when is it? When is that time? If we don't make an appointment, you usually don't get together, do you? You know, how many times I'll say, well, I want to get together with this person, and weeks and months drag out because we haven't sat down and looked at our calendars and said, we're getting together on this day. So it determines a time, that when you pray. But then he tells us two things that are really interesting. He tells us two things. He says how not to pray. And then he kind of follows that with how to pray. And then he says, again, how not to pray. And then he follows that with telling us how to pray. Look at it when he says how not to pray. He said, don't pray to be seen of men. That's verse 5. These Pharisees, these religious people, think by standing out in the streets and people seeing them pray that they're doing something great when really they've already have their reward. And he said, in opposition to that or in contrast to that, look at verse 6, but this is how you are to pray. Go into your room and pray in secret where no one sees. But the Father sees, and look what it says, he will reward thee openly. Do you know we serve a God that loves to reward his people? Huh? Those who come to God must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of those who seek him diligently. He loves to reward his people. So we're not to do it to be seen of men. We're to do it privately, intimately, in a way that we receive our reward openly from God. Then he says another way not to pray. When you get down to verse 7, don't pray using vain repetitions. Don't just stand up and pray flowery prayers and, you know, that everybody, you know, are so wonderfully blessed to hear and think, wow, isn't that beautiful prayer? This past year at Thanksgiving, me and Amy have been the last several years going to Sedan, Kansas for Thanksgiving. That's my daughter Jessie Kate's in-laws, and he invites us all up, and we have a great time up there for Thanksgiving. Well, I'm part of the family now, so when we get together with all their extended family, you know what always happens to the preacher? I'm the professional prayer, you know, so they always have to say, well, they've got a preacher here, you pray. And so this year, you know, they called on me to pray, and I prayed a prayer, and when they got through, they were all real quiet. And I thought, did I offend somebody? And one of them spoke up and said, boy, it sure is good to have somebody here that knows how to pray, you know. And I said, well, who used to pray? They said, well, we didn't really know. We'd read a scripture, and we didn't really know how to pray, you know, do it. So I'm the professional prayer, you know. That's not what it's about. Not sure you do those. We pray in church. We do pray publicly. I pray over the city council meeting this week and bless our city and bless our council and our mayor. I do those things. We do pray out in public. There's a place and role for that, to stop and recognize the worth of God in any place and to do an invocation or those things. There's roles for that. But Jesus said, you know, don't pray with a bunch of words to impress other people. And then he says, here's how you pray. Here's how you pray. You can't get it anymore. You know, wish I could have been back there with Jesus and I could have asked him how to pray. Well, the disciples did ask him. In Luke's covering of this event, Luke says the disciples came to him and says, teach us how to pray. And he said, here's how you pray. And he gave them the Lord's Prayer. And so here he's teaching us. These are the words. You know in these five verses, everything you need to know about God is right there. Everything. Listen, look at this with me. Hang on. Watch this. Our Father, the fatherhood of God. That's what we're talking about today. Hallowed be your name, the holiness of God. Kingdom come, the kingdom of God. Will be done, will of God. The purpose of God on earth as it is in heaven. The provision of God, our daily bread. The forgiveness of God, forgive us our debts as we forgive those that are indebted to us. The guidance of God, lead us not into temptation. And the deliverance of God, deliver us from evil. And the perspective of God. You know how you end a prayer meeting? You know how a Christian comes up out of their prayer closet? They come up saying, thine is the kingdom, thine is the power, and thine is the glory. Your perspective has always changed when you spend time with God in prayer. Wow, everything, all kinds of stuff. Now, I'm not going to preach on every one of those, but I do want to take just a moment today to talk about the fatherhood of God and how it begins. Think about this. When I pray, I start thinking of those phrases. And I could spend time just on our Father in heaven. Well, how can I do that? First of all, I see that there are key relationships that are established that I have that really affect my prayer life. All right, you ready? Look at this. First of all, a relationship with the Father. Here it is. You say, our Father. He said to address God as Father. I'm glad to have my brother here today. And we were blessed with a good father growing up. He was a flawed man, just like all of us are. But he was a good father. He took care of us. He guided us. He gave us wisdom, challenged us. He protected us. He did all the things a good father does. But I'm very aware that some people didn't have that in their life. They look back at maybe an absent father or even worse, an abusive father in their life. Well, you know what? You have to always remember what the Bible tells us in Psalm 27. It said, when my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take care of me. So you don't look through the flaws of earthly roles, but you go to the perfect role of the great father, the good father, the one that does all things correctly, and that is our heavenly father. So we turn to him as a father. Now look, let's just dispense with the gender stuff here today, because when I say father, and this is how God is to be addressed, Jesus said, but we all know God is not a male. God is a spirit. And we don't refer to him that way, but Jesus gave us this way to relate to him because of the responsibilities or the things that he does for us, like an earthly father would be responsible for as well. When I speak of sonship or being a son of the Father, I'm obviously talking about daughters as well. There is neither male nor female in Christ Jesus. You know what Paul did? He got up every day of his life as a Pharisee before he got converted. And you know what a Pharisee did? Every day of his life, he got up and he opened his prayers. And this is what he honestly did. He said, God, I thank you. I'm not a Gentile. I'm thankful, Lord, that I'm not a woman. You know, that's what he would get up and say. He'd say those things. I'm thankful I'm not a slave. That's what a Pharisee prayed every day of his life. Guess what happened when he met Jesus? About 10 years later, he's traveling in the region of Galatia and writes them a letter. And he says, there's neither male nor female. It's not I'm superior to women anymore. And he said, there's neither slave nor free. It's not that he's superior because he's free. And he said, and Jew or Gentile, it doesn't matter. When Jesus met, all those human distinctions exploded. And I'll tell you something very clearly. That's why there is absolutely, and we all know this, but there's absolutely no place for racism in the body of Christ in any way possible. Why? Because you meet Jesus, it explodes all that junk out of your life. He loves us all. And so Paul knew that and he came into that. But the most surprising, downright shocking thing that Jesus taught us was to address God as Father. No one had ever done that up until the time of Jesus. No one. I mean, they would never call God Father. That's too intimate. You don't find but a few references to God's fatherhood in the entire Old Testament. In the time preceding Jesus' arrival into this world, all the writings of the Jews, there's no idea of calling God Father. God's name was so holy to them, they would never talk to God in those terms. You know, when I learned Hebrew, when I was in school and we went through Hebrew, we learned something about the ancient Hebrews. When they would read their Torah, when they'd read the scrolls, when they came to the divine name of God, which you see in your English versions with a capital L-O-R-D. And that's always the divine name of God. When they came to it, they wouldn't speak it. They would substitute another generic word when they came to it at that time. And they would say Adonai when they came to it, which is another generic name. They would not speak it. So guess what? We only had four consonants. We have no idea how it's pronounced today, because they never spoke it over and over. When I was in Hebrew, learning Hebrew, when we would read the Hebrew Old Testament and do recitations in class, when we came to the divine name of God, we were expected to say Adonai. What was the option? Well, we've looked at it and tried to insert some vowels, and we've said it's Jehovah. And then other people says, no, it should be pronounced Yahweh. We don't know how it was pronounced. It was such a holy name, and the Jews treasured it so much, they would not speak it. And they would not say it out loud. They never thought of a relationship with God as a father. But here comes Jesus, and he not only says Father, he says Abba, Father, which is the term of endearment you would have for your dad or your pop or your daddy or whatever. It was that term of endearment, really intimate words. And it was scandalous for Jesus as a rabbi to call God Abba. But oh, did he not have a revelation for us? Because mark it down, folks. The reason Jesus came into this earth was for a planet of spiritual orphans to find out they have a heavenly Father. And I want you to know, he came to tell us you can know him because he loves you and he cares for you. And then all of a sudden, some of those psalmists and some of those things start making sense, because there's one back there somewhere that says something like, as a father pities a child, so the Lord pities his own children. Oh, wow. You start seeing the heart of God coming forth everywhere. Jesus taught us that. And let me just explode this other myth, too. You hear all the time in the liberal world that people so open-minded, their brains have fallen out, you know. They start saying stuff like this. Well, the eternal fatherhood of God. God is father to all human beings. And the eternal brotherhood of the believer, a brotherhood of human beings. In other words, we're all brothers and sisters. You know, that's not true. That's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches he is a creator of all, but he's a father to his people and his people alone. That's why we say our Father. He's not your father unless you've come in repentance and change of mind of the direction of your life and you've asked him into your life, Jesus Christ, to be Lord of your life. Then you can pray to the Father through the Son's meritorious action that he accomplished for us on Calvary. Wow. Our Father. That's such a privilege. You see, I can't even get in the prayer. This is where you start thinking, God, I have the privilege of calling you Father. Why? Because you sent your only Son to die on the cross for my sins. Listen to this verse in Romans 8:14. And by the way, you think he's Father of everybody? Well, Jesus told a group of people, you're of your father, the devil. Well, God isn't their father. Jesus said the devil was their father. But listen to Romans 8:14. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. Sons and daughters, you understand what I'm saying? These are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by which we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit we're children of God. Wow. I've been adopted into God's family. And I can tell you there's been moments in my life when I have faced things that were so much bigger than me and I didn't know what to do. And you're supposed to know it all as the father. You're supposed to be able to fix everything as the pastor. And you get in these situations sometimes and you just make everybody think you know what you're doing. And then you crawl in your prayer closet and you say, Abba, Father. Abba, Father. I've never spoken those words that I haven't felt a message from God or I haven't felt his presence come upon me. Never, because he loves his children. As a father, I've been adopted into that family. I'm not in fear. What was it Michelle said in Bible study this morning? She said it this way. She said, the first thing you think of when you think of the name God tells everything about you. And you know, see this fearful God hurling down fireballs from heaven to try to just be a cosmic killjoy and try to just not let anybody have any fun. No, I want to tell you what, I think of a father when I think of him. And I think of him as the perfect father. Now, what does the father do? And here's what a father does. Every father in this world does this. Matter of fact, we just take it even bigger. Anybody that's in authority does this. You know, it doesn't matter where your position is. If you're a boss at work or if you're a father in the home or whatever it may be, this is the kind of people we lovingly submit ourselves to. What do? Number one, they provide for us. A father provides. Oh, Paul had some very hard words to say for someone who claimed to be a Christian who would not provide for his own. Very strong words about that, because a father by nature provides. A father works. A father makes sure that his children have what they need. I don't have time in our little time here together this morning, but I read this book this week where a guy went all the way through the Gospel of John and looked at how many times the Father is mentioned by Jesus and by others in there, and every one of them relate to one aspect, and that is this: he's generous. He's generous with sharing his glory. He's generous with his protection. He's generous with his home. Jesus said, I'm going to my Father's house and I'm going to build many places of abode that are mansions for you there. He's always generous. He's generous with His joy. His joy is not like the world gives, but like He gives. And it's full in us. The Father gives. The Father gives His Son generously. The Father gives His Spirit generously. The Father gives of Himself generously over and over. He's generous in His provisions for us. There is nothing, nothing that God has held back from you that you need. Nothing. Not one thing, not any lack in our life at all. You may think it's something. If you don't have it, you don't need it. You don't need to win the lottery and let your character be exploded. You know, you don't need this. You don't need that. But listen, everything that pertains to life and godliness, the Father lavishly provides us with those things. He's held back nothing. The Father does this too. He provides, but He also protects. Later we'll see in the prayer, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. A father protects, a father takes care of his own. And I love the psalmist in Psalm 91 who said, he who dwells in the secret place, where did he tell us to pray? In the secret place. Get in that secret place. And he said, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And don't tell you another thing that anybody in authority does that you willingly submit to. They promote you. A father, what does he do? He provides, he protects, and he promotes. He promotes you. You know, that don't mean just going different levels, which he does that too. You know how he told disciples one day, he said, no longer do I call you servants, now I'm calling you friends. You know, you do get advanced along in your relationship with God and moving along, but he promotes you in other ways. He puts opportunities in front of you for you to display and experience all that he has created you to do. He provides. He promotes his people. That's what a father does. Well, I told you there were three relationships, so let me give these last two and we'll close. But a father, I have a relationship with a father. See how you can't pray this thing? You get an hour? I don't have time. I can't get past the first three words. I get to call him father. But there's another word. I have another relationship. He says, our father. That's plural. Our father. That means I have a relationship with the brotherhood. The sisterhood, the family of God. I have brothers and sisters in Christ that have the same Holy Spirit in them that I have in me, and they're working it out in their life as I'm working it out, and we work it out together, and there's nothing like the party of getting together with brothers and sisters in Christ. Church gathering is nothing but rapture practice, folks. Get together and think about the day when we come together and sing like we've never been able to sing before, to see Him not by faith, but to see Him as He is and to enjoy that. So we come and get a little taste of heaven every time we get together. Our Father, I'm in communion with my brothers and sisters in the kingdom. It's not a solitary journey. We have somebody going on the journey with us, and we appreciate that. This is why the writer to Hebrews said, forsake not the assembling yourselves together. Not some command. You don't need to miss church. You need to be in church. I'm not calling you to some religious institution. I'm not calling you to some religious rule. I'm calling you to the party. I'm calling you to the party. We meet for the party every Sunday at 10:30. Show up for the party. We're going to get together. We're going to encourage one another. We're going to pray for one another. We're going to help one another. And we're going to worship God together. And we're going to experience things together that we can never experience alone. Our Father. This whole prayer is a prayer of communion, praying it together in sync with my brothers and sisters in Christ. Relationship with the brotherhood. And then I got a third relationship. Ooh. Our Father, as the old King James says, who art in heaven. I've got a relationship with heaven. I've got a relationship with home. How important is that? I love Texas. I really do. I love Texas. I love the Tennessee-Texas connection. We gave our best from Tennessee to come down here and fight in Alamo, and that's why it's called the Volunteer State to this day. I grew up in East Tennessee, the real Tennessee, where the mountains are. And the great history is. My grandfathers and great-grandfathers lived there. I just love that tradition. And no matter where I go in the world, down in the Amazon rainforest, it's so beautiful down there. It's hot, but it's beautiful. Go to India and minister there and the wonderful culture that is that great nation. Go to Europe. Go to Israel and walk where Jesus walked. Go to Brazil. Go all these places you can go and visit. There's nothing like getting home, is there? And you know what? When I go back up there and I ride through those mountains, you know, I just feel I'm at home. I'm at home. No matter where I've lived, no matter how much I've liked where I've lived, that's always going to be home. I like that. Well, guess what? I have a more permanent home than East Tennessee or even Dallas, Texas. And that permanent home is a city that has a builder and maker and whose foundations are God Himself. I have a home one day that's an eternal home, and I can't wait to gather in that home. And God gives me now on this earth a little heaven on earth. Heaven is in the believer before the believer ever gets to heaven. And we get together and we pray, and when we come together and pray to God, I know my relationship to Him as Father. I know my relationship to my brother, sister, Christ. But oh, I thank God when I get together that I get a little aroma of my eternal abode upon me. Oh, I love the thought of that. What's in heaven? Healing's in heaven. Hope realized is in heaven. Faith. There's no more funerals in heaven. This is the place we're going. You know, there's some people in heaven that I want to see. Neil Graham, can't wait to fellowship with him again. One of my dear, dear friends, Barb Tweedy, loved her so much. Can't wait to see her again. Miss Evelyn Culpepper. One of the dearest saints in the world. Oh, I miss her so much. Can't wait to see her. Kathy Carlton, what a woman of God she was. What a great woman. Died so much in faith. Most importantly, Jesus Himself is in heaven. Ah, I'm longing for it. You say, well, we just need to be more focused here. I like what C.S. Lewis said. He said, the people that are more focused there are more effective here. Those that are focused here are less effective here for the kingdom of God. I've got a whiff of heaven. I'm traveling on. I know there's a rest for me. I know there is a place to dwell forever and ever with the Lord. And I'm not going to be lying around on clouds with a harp in my hand and a halo over my head. No, I'm going to be ruling and reigning with Jesus Christ over His expanding universe forever and ever and ever. I've already told God, I'm up for being in charge of the libraries of heaven. I'll be glad to take care of all those books. Ah, we say cheap things like that, but it's real. It's real, isn't it? We're on a journey to a city. We have a city beside us, which is Babylon, the spirit of Babylon around us, the world itself. We have a city behind us, wherever we've left in life, the Ur of the Chaldees for Abraham. But I'm telling you, we always keep our faiths forward because we have a city before us that we are journeying towards. Oh, I long for that day. No sin, no sickness, no demons. Satan himself is not there. The aroma of heaven comes down and meets us in prayer to remind us we're journeying on. Amen. Amen. Well, we got to visit our old friends Jake and Sam before we leave here because I've got to remind you of what I'm trying to give you and what God's trying to give you as this church. Jake and Sam. What about Jake and Sam? Jake was a game warden. Sam was a fisherman. Jake would get together, the game warden, every week and see all the guys going out in their boats to go fishing. And he got a little suspicious of Sam because Sam brought back the biggest and most fish every week. And he said, something's going on here and I'm going to find out what it is. So all the guys gathered to go out fishing one day and there was the game warden, Jake. And he said, Sam, I'm going with you today. I'm going to see how you get all these fish. Sam goes over into a little cove, an area where nobody is at. And he says, well, he's got a private fishing hole. Ah, he's got something that nobody, but then Sam did something unbelievable. He didn't take out a rod and reel. He didn't take out any bait. He reached under his seat and pulled a stick of dynamite out. He lit the fuse on that dynamite and threw it over in the water. You know what happens. It goes down and down and then boom! And I mean, the boat shakes. Water sprays up everywhere. And these big old bass are laying there in the water like this, stunned. He gets a net out and starts just netting those big old bass and putting them in the boat. Jake, eyeballs are this big. He's reaching for his citation book so fast he can't. I can't believe you did that. That's illegal. You can't fish that way. I'm going to throw the book at you. And he's getting ready to write him up. About that time, Sam just takes another puff of a cigar, reaches underneath his seat, lights another stick of dynamite and throws it to the game warden. And he says, you're going to talk all day or you're going to fish? Guess who else got guilty real fast? Oh, my goodness. Listen to me. Listen to me. God's throwing a piece of dynamite to the church at Trophy Lakes. Said, y'all going to talk all day? Y'all going to fish? I mean, the explosive power available for us in unity to cry out to God and hear answers from God and see nations changed. He puts that dynamite right in our presence. It's just prayer. Call upon me, and I will show you great and mighty things you've not even thought about. Oh, receive it, church. Receive it. Let's take steps forward. Let's move deeper. Let's get stronger. Let's move further along in our journey with God in prayer. Let's pray together today.